Good morning, and I'd like to welcome everyone to this, the 20th meeting of Standards, Procedures and Public Appointments Committee in 2024. I've received no apologies this morning. Our first agenda item is for the committee to decide on whether to take business in private, and that in particular is whether to take items 3 and 4 from the agenda. Agenda item 3 is consideration of the evidence heard on the Scottish Elections Representation and Reform Bill. And agenda item 4 is consideration of correspondence from the Parliamentary Bureau on the allocation of time for opposition business. Are members happy to take that in private? Excellent, thank you. And then move to agenda item 2, which is indeed the Scottish Elections Representation and Reform Bill. And we are joined today by Jamie Hepburn, MSP, Minister for Parliamentary Business. Good morning, Minister. And he's joined by Ian Huckenhall, Elections Bill Team Leader from the Scottish Government, Chris Nicholson, who's Solicitor and Head of Branch, Constitutional Reform and External Affairs, Scottish Government, and Lorraine Walkinshaw, Lawyer, Scottish Government Legal Director. Can I welcome you all to the meeting this morning? And I think, Minister, you would like to open with some words.
Yes, indeed, Convener. I'll be as brief as I can, but can I begin by thanking you and colleagues in the committee for inviting me today to give further evidence to you on the Scottish Elections Representation and Reform Bill. As this is my first appearance before the committee, Convener, can I take the opportunity to thank you for the work undertaken to scrutinise the bill at stage one, and I very much look forward to working with you and the committee as we move into stage two. Convener, we have been working over the summer on a number of stage two changes, or planned stage two changes to the bill, including my meeting with a number of other members of Parliament who have expressed an interest in perhaps bringing forward their own amendments. I hope my letter last week on our considerations was helpful in that regard, although I'm aware there was a slight typo in the letter. For absolute clarity, on its first page, the adjustment to the period of postponement for local government elections is to a maximum of 4 weeks and not a minimum of 4 weeks, as it said. And under some officials have been in touch with your clerks to clarify this matter. As my letter explained, we have been preparing amendments in response to points raised in evidence and in response to the committee's stage one report. I'd like to repeat my thanks, not just to the committee, but of course to those who provided evidence to you in your considerations. The amendments being prepared include provisions on emergency rescheduling of elections. This involves requiring decision makers to publish a statement of reasons in taking a decision on rescheduling. It will also adjust the maximum postponement period for local government elections from 2 to 4 weeks. Amendments are also being prepared on electoral innovation pilots to add the Electoral Commission as a statutory consultee and to ensure that pilots can encompass election registration changes. The letter also set out in its annexes proposed changes to the constitution of the Electoral Management Board for Scotland and proposals to disqualify those subject to sex offender notification requirements from elected office. On the Electoral Management Board, we are in continued discussion with them and others on its constitution, and I am keen to ensure that there is as much consensus on that matter as possible. One particular question concerns the extent to which there should be a formal provision for Scottish ministers and indeed and or the Scottish Parliament to request that the board undertake certain activity, whilst of course respecting their operational independence. One option might be for the Scottish Parliament to set out its priorities for elections in a statement. On disqualification of elected members, we continue to give active consideration to these matters, including whether or not there should be any difference in approach between councillors and MSPs. Whilst it seems instinctive to apply the same rules across the board, and I should say this is the position I lean towards to, there are some important differences. In particular, we do not have a process for councillors accused of certain conduct to be suspended, and whilst we do not as of yet have any recall mechanism for MSPs, as a Parliament we have already agreed by resolution that in principle there should be one, and we may well have the opportunity to consider this matter further if Graeme Simpson takes forward his Members' Bill. Convener, whilst I've set out some of the Government's thinking on changes to be made to this bill, I very much continue to consider this to be Parliament's bill. As such, I'm very keen to continue to hear views from across the Scottish Parliament, including, of course, this committee, as to how we refine and improve the bill to put in place the best possible legislation. I look forward to discussing these matters with you today, and I, Ian, Chris and Lorraine are very happy to answer any questions the committee has for us today.
Excellent. Can I thank you very much for that opening statement, Minister? And indeed, with regard to the clarification of the two letters that were received and your confirmation today that was of a maximum postponement of 4 weeks, do you have any concerns in relation to using the phrase almost minimum and maximum, given the challenge that was indicated in the evidence that we heard that there would need to be at least 4 weeks to rejig the machinery of election to take place safely and securely? So I was wondering whether or not what consideration you'd given to it being 4 weeks set at that, or a wording other than a minimum and maximum to meet the practical evidence that we heard that it would be very difficult to do it in less than 4 weeks.
So on that point, of course, that's why we have changed the period from 2 weeks to 4 weeks. It's a reasonable question, Convener. What I would say is I'm not perturbed by the use of the term maximum, or indeed, although we used it in error, potentially the use of the term minimum. I suppose there'd be a reasonable question as to what that defined period should be. Now, I think for hopefully what would be self-evident reasons, it would be sensible to prescribe a maximum period in legislation, because we don't want an extension of the process without limit. The reasonable question would be, is 4 weeks correct, or should it be another prescribed period? In that regard, I'm open-minded. If it's felt that it should be slightly longer, I would suggest only slightly longer, then that's something I'm quite willing to hear. I mean, we've heard quite clearly from those responsibility for organising elections that 2 weeks was too tight. It probably required about 4 weeks. If that means we should have a bit more leeway, I'm quite open to considering looking at that period again.
So would it be fair to say that setting it at 4 weeks, irrespective of the cause, may be too restrictive? We seem to have an agreement that 2 weeks is insufficient time, so we're in an interesting bidding war between 2 weeks and 4 weeks, and whether or not that in itself is going to cause us problems. I wonder whether you're prepared to sort of go away and discuss this with those that gave evidence to see whether or not there can be an agreement on, in principle, whether 4 weeks is the right time or what the wording is, because I'm concerned about maximum because it means that there could be 1 day postponement, which will cause chaos. I'm similarly concerned about minimum because it may need to be less than 4 weeks.
No, we will obviously continue that discussion, I should say. Clearly, we've had that discussion, and that's why we have responded. 4 weeks was the term or the period that was suggested to us that would be sensible. Now, if it's felt sensible to prescribe a little longer, then I'm happy for us to look at that. I would probably suggest it would be a significantly longer period of time. And equally, if it's felt sensible to suggest that there should be a minimum period, I'm more than willing and open to hear what that might be from those who organise the elections, or indeed if this committee has a perspective too.
Excellent. Thank you, Minister. I'm now going to hand you over to the more than capable hands of Oliver for the next little section.
Thank you, Convener. I wanted to ask some more on disqualification, particularly around sex offender notification requirements. I know you touched on it in your opening statement, but I mean, as obviously the committee looked at this, to me, there's a clear, reason to act in this area, but I want to kind of understand how it's going to work in practice, and really understand the government's thinking. It was previously indicated that disqualification was being proposed where an individual was subject to the sex offender notification requirements. The committee understood this to be where an individual had been convicted of certain offences and was required to appear on the sex offenders register. In your recent letter, there's a note of those subject to the sex offender notification requirements where there is no conviction, but a relevant order. Can you explain the difference in these and explain a little bit more on your latest thinking on what would trigger disqualification.
So I think this has come around as a consequence of clear concern. We've seen it, of course, Mr. Mundell, that there have been some folk who have been elected as councillors who have then committed an offence, yep, and who have not been able to be disqualified. That is, has been a cause for concern for the public, for me, I'm sure for other members of the committee, for those who have to work with them as colleagues, for the people they represent, and that has compelled us to consider the matter and to act. So that's the rationale, and I think it is broadly accepted that that is a sensible rationale. In terms of the threshold, clearly you have to pick a threshold by which you would disqualify someone, and it seems in our view reasonable to say that those who are subject to sex offender notification requirements, that meets the threshold. In relation to your question around the slight difference between those who are subject to such requirements who've been convicted and those who've not been convicted, I'll pick up on that as best I can just now, but happy to provide more evidence in writing if that would be helpful. Broadly speaking, you know, most of those people will have been convicted. They will have been through the courts. They will have been convicted, and that's why they'll be subject to a sex offender notification requirement. There are some who will not have been subject to conviction. Of course, it's a part of our criminal justice system where those who are found that they can't be held criminally culpable for having committed an offence by dint of their state of mental well-being, they would, instead of being held in the prison estate or being convicted, be held in our hospital estate. But they could still be subject to these requirements. We think it's still sensible that they would be disqualified on that basis, because the same issues of public concern about wider public safety would, I think, remain. There is also a slight difference in Scottish jurisdiction by comparison to jurisdiction in England and Wales. In England and Wales, you can be subject to a sex offender notification requirement on point of caution rather than conviction, and we would propose that that would meet the threshold to be disqualified here in Scotland as well. So that's the slight nuance, that's the slight difference. There are a few others as well, but we'll perhaps pick that up in writing with the committee convener, and that might provide the committee a bit more detail.
I think that's helpful, because I think one of the concerns I have, you know, is that you could be in a position where you've got returning officers, you know, across different authorities and things, having to interpret, you know, very complicated circumstances. I think it's imperative, you know, that you know these rules are clear. So, moving beyond that, in terms of, you know, in terms of what you're saying, I mean, you know, I'm minded towards that position, but you know, are you confident that would meet kind of legal proportionality kind of tests, particularly given, you know, that some individuals can be subject to these requirements, you know, indefinitely? Are you confident that's, you know, that in terms of setting that threshold, you know, that it would be legally proportionate?
Insofar, and this is where it gets a little tricky, because there are prescribed through the Venice Commission in relation to Article 3 of ECHR, there is a difference laid out in respect of local government and parliamentary elections. So there is a nuance in relation to this. But yes, and as far as we have looked at it, we think it's entirely proportionate to be applied in the case of councillors. Candidly, and I've made that point in my opening remarks, Mr. Mundell, I lean towards a position whereby we should be looking to have equivalence for councillors and MSPs. There are these nuances that we'll need to look to, but if we get to a position where we think we can do it, yes, in those circumstances, I think it would be proportionate as well. Of course, it's the case that it can be prescribed that the requirements under these orders are indefinite, but there are, of course, review periods as well for such. So, long answer short, that probably was a long answer for one that could have been short. Yes, I do think it's proportionate. Can I go back to your what you said in your remarks there, though, because I do think it's important to get this on the record, not least because returning officers will probably pick up what you said and come back to you. We would not propose, and it's a feature of our system just now, people are disbarred from standing for elected office at this juncture right now. We would not propose, because I think it would be impossible for returning officers to police that at point of nomination. If you look at the 2022 and the 2017 local government elections, for example, there were over 2,500 candidates stood for elected office at those elections, asking returning officers to police that. Whilst I would understand the rationale, I think it would become very, very difficult indeed. So I must put that on the record. It may be an area that we want to explore further. I think it would be reasonable to do so, but I think it is necessary for me to make that clear at this stage.
Yeah. So, I mean, I understand. I mean, our current system, I was going to come on to this, our current system places the responsibility on the candidate to sort of self-declare on a range of issues that may prevent you putting yourself forward. But the reality is, if someone does go into that process, their nomination is open, as I understand it, to challenge. People could in the kind of, in the election window, bring information to light that would potentially disbar a nominated candidate, and it's sort of what you've. That's where I think having clear rules is important. Is that a circumstance you've considered? Would it be your view that these individuals should be blocked from candidacy, as well as actually being elected?
Well, indeed, yeah, they shouldn't be eligible to stand in the first place, and I suppose that's the point and the purpose of notice of polling. We publish the names of candidates so that members of the public can see who's been nominated, and if anyone spots a name that is cause for concern, they can then report that. I think we've also had evidence provided from returning officers that they obviously exercise their judgment as well. If they become aware of someone that is a cause for concern, then they would take the appropriate action at that stage too. So, we are adding a new category of disqualification. We're already adding a new category, or in the bill as drafted, looking to add a new category of those disqualified from eligibility for office in terms of intimidatory behaviour. So, notwithstanding adding these as categories, effectively they're added to the process that we have in place just now for people being nominated and standing for office, which I think by and large has served as well.
Okay. And in terms of the amendments, I know you talked about having met with MSPs across the Parliament and detailed work on amendments. In terms of this section of the bill, given the committee's interests, will you be in a position to share amendments with the committee either at this stage or in short order so that we can decide whether or not we need to take more evidence? Because I think obviously some of this is quite detailed, and it wasn't something we got a huge amount of detailed evidence on in stage one.
No,
but
I think
we agree on the principle,
yeah,
but it's making sure that it's workable.
I think it's a reasonable point, and if the committee wants more information to enable it to take more evidence, then I'm absolutely happy to furnish the committee with that information. In terms of it necessarily being the actual amendments as written, that starts to create a new process in terms of our list of considerations, so I wouldn't definitively rule it out. But equally, I'm also keen the committee could be able to inform what amendments might look like. So I think probably I'm more inclined to give as much information as possible around our intention. And if the committee wants to take more evidence, then, well, far be it from me. It's entirely up to the committee to consider whether it wants to do that. And if it does, and then provides its the outcome of its deliberations to us, we will of course reflect on that.
Thank you. And just to pursue a couple of those points, I mean, if we look at the disqualification, at the minute when someone puts their name forward for election and they go through that short period of time where there can be notices saying you can't for X, Y, and Z, the difference in this case is even if that doesn't happen, they still could never have stood. And it's at what stage that becomes apparent and what the challenges are. And I think we've seen from your evidence this morning, for which I thank you, that there is a real complexity in this with the potential for an extension effectively to a non-criminal order for it. And it is something that it is in the detail that actually the challenge lies. You mentioned about the Venice Commission. Is it the Scottish Government's view that actually elected individuals at local authority level and here within this Parliament should be held to the same standards rather than the nuance that you hint at that perhaps the Venice Commission are talking about?
I mean, broadly speaking, and in so much as we're able to, yes, and I think I've indicated that that sometimes comes up against other legal factors that we're going to have to consider, but in broad terms, yes, I do think there should be equivalence.
So, Perry, that's very helpful. And can I just ask for a clarification about the relevant stakeholders that the Scottish Government have engaged with on this specific matter relating to the sex offenders notification requirements and the disqualification? Who are the people that you've engaged with? I mean, I don't want to assume anything, but I would imagine Police Scotland have had an input, criminal justice, social workers, and even the human rights bodies. Who is it that you've reached out to and who has fed back?
So certainly we've heard from electoral returning officers in terms of some of the complexities around administration. We've engaged with Police Scotland as far as I'm aware. Of course, there's also been a discussion internally in government, different parts of government have obviously discussed this, but I'll maybe bring in Ian to just see if he can provide a slightly more comprehensive list, but of course we're happy to also pick that up in writing with you.
We have highlighted it to COSLA, particularly in relation to councillors, and our on the justice scope it is more our colleagues within the Justice Department of the Scottish, well, Justice Director of the Scottish Government. We've had quite a lot of debate about these orders and their equivalent measures. We've also discussed it with the Welsh Government, which has made a provision along these lines for both members of the Senate and for councillors, and with the UK Government, which has made it for councillors in England already. So that this approximate prohibition is already in place elsewhere in the UK, so we've had those discussions. Welsh Government officials have confirmed that they've not really set out anything new for the police in Wales on this. It's not really led to a direct change for police services. It's more, this is an additional disqualification factor, treated much the same as any other disqualification factor.
Thank you. So the confidence in relation to the human rights element of it, and whether or not effectively a never-ending order would lead to a never-ending ban, disqualification, stand for elected office, is the confidence that the Scottish Government have to assert that the proposal is reasonable is one that's actually been developed more by internal discussion between yourselves, and I understand the Welsh Government have tackled the same issues rather than those outside of this place.
Yes.
I mean, what I would say, can your deliberations on this, of course, have not finished. So
no.
The discussion will continue, but we're happy to provide you with some detail as to our discussions thus far, and we will continue discussing it with those who we consider to have a relevant interest in this matter, and that will inform our final position.
Yeah, that's certainly helpful, because I think, you know, to echo what the committee Oliver's already said, you know, the basic principle we're in agreement with. However, the second we seem to delve into it, we sometimes seem to be confronted with more questions than we are answers. And I think given the importance of this matter for, you know, both individuals, voters, trust in democracy, it's an important one to get at. Are there any other matters on that point from the committee before I move on to the next matter. Okay, I'm grateful. I was going to now turn to the Electoral Management Board, and can I thank you for your very comprehensive coverage of this in the letters that you've sent. There's a couple of areas that I'd like to pick up on, and the first is in relation to the proposed constitution. You have set out the areas that the constitution would need to cover. Is there anything further than that in existence that would assist the committee with regard to this matter?
Not at this stage, convener. I'm keen that we provide that to you as soon as possible, but I thought it would be helpful to give a sense of the broad areas that we're looking at, but I'm happy to provide more information once we have it.
That's very helpful, and I may have been slightly surprised if it was actually in existence, because obviously as at the moment a living document that needs to be created, and I know you need to reach out to various people on that. There seems to be an agreement that a corporate body entity is the right legal entity to have for it. When it comes to the finance for this corporate body, you point out the intention would to be funded in the same way as the Political Parties Election Referendum Act 2000 sets out, that it is a reimbursement to the Commission rather than it having, for sake of clarity, something like our commissioners have, where they present a budget to, and it's answered that. Are you confident that that model of funding will be satisfactory going forward?
I think it would, but again, you know, this is subject to discussion. Of course, we've also suggested that rather than this being a body that's sponsored by the Scottish Government, it could be more appropriate that it's sponsored by the Scottish Parliament. That's taken us into dialogue with the Scottish Parliament. As you can imagine, Presiding Officer and the Chief Executive of the Scottish Parliament have an interest in that. So they may take a different perspective, and I think we just want to land on a point of agreement with them on that.
Yes, and that actually absolutely follows up to my next question on it. What discussions have you had with the Scottish Parliament, open brackets, corporate body, close brackets, rather than the Parliament as in where we sit in the chamber, about that? And are you able to share what their views of taking on another body?
I think I would be loath to share their views. I think I'd rather let them share their views. Far be it for me to speak for the corporate body, but I have spoken briefly with the presiding officer about it. I've also spoken with the chief executive, and officials have been in contact with the Scottish Parliament officials to discuss it as well. So I think whilst I wouldn't want to speak in detail, I think there's I get a sense that there's a willingness, but clearly we need to finalise arrangements just to get that over the line.
That's helpful, and no doubt the committee will inquire also in relation to this matter, because it is the funding question, and this Parliament, as in its the various committees, have taken a great interest in the commissioners that exist in Scotland and the cost of that and the other entities, because at the end of the day, part of ensuring confidence in the system is that we know that there's adequate funding there for it to happen. And when we look at discussions about the pilot scheme, some of these things are not inexpensive. And the memorandum rightly highlighted the unknown quantity with regard to the costs of the corporate body that's being proposed. So we may well continue to press you on that for further details.
Yeah. Could I just pick up on that?
Yeah, please do. Please
I mean,
do.
I suppose in respect to whilst we're creating it as a corporate entity, the Electoral Management Board exists, so it's not as if we're creating a new entity. We provide funding just now, so I can tell you now we provide about £200,000 per annum to the Electoral Management Board. Yes, there could be a question as to whether or not that suffices as it moves into a new legal status. So that's something we're looking at just now. And the commitment, of course, is that requires a new financial memorandum. We will produce that, we'll provide it to this committee, and of course the Finance Committee, who we know are taking a great interest in the financial memoranda.
And certainly those that currently host the voluntary EMB may look differently as a non-voluntary entity in its
Indeed.
Right.
Yeah.
One of the things that's been talked about is the challenge of using priority statements, because obviously the EMB must remain, in essence, arm's length from those who it is overseeing the election of. Do you want to explain about, I mean, I understand the Scottish Government's priority statement, but you've indicated that potentially the Scottish Parliament, and I presume by that you mean the Chamber of the Parliament rather than corporate body, could indicate a priority statement. Do you want to explain that a little further?
So clearly there's a fine balance to be struck here. You know, on an operational basis, we must let the Electoral Management Board get on with its work, and clearly we would not want to, either the government or I think Parliament would want to be seen to cut across them in terms of their operation. But we are also democratically elected representatives, and there is nothing wrong with us being able to identify issues and lay that out in a statement to the board for something to have regard to, not that it specifically prescribes or directs them to do anything in particular, but something that they should be aware of in the context of their work. So that's the intention. There is then a question as to where that responsibility should lie. Should it be with government? Should it be with Parliament? You then raise the reasonable question. Yes, I would envisage it being Parliament as a whole, but could the corporate body also be raising issues? Could it be a mixture of both government and Parliament? So these are issues that, well, frankly, I'm keen to hear a perspective on from other members, because we've not reached a definitive position in respect of that. You know, I understand, and people are right to caution, absolutely right to caution against anything that would be seen to compromise the independence of the Electoral Management Board. I would observe that it is already in practice or in place that the Electoral Commission, for example, is responsible to the Scottish Yes. Parliament for its activities in Scotland. But there is provision for the Scottish Government to fund certain activities for the Electoral Commission with agreement with the Electoral Commission, and they still are able to operate entirely independently of government. So these things are achievable.
Absolutely, they are achievable. And again, much to the reference to the first one, the devil is always in the detail of that. And actually, you know, to a predominant level, it's right to say that elections are handled, you know, very successfully here in Scotland. There is a great deal of confidence in them. And one of the assurances that this committee is seeking, and one of the roles that we have, is to make sure that as this becomes a piece of legislation, that same vehicle of trust and security can go forward. Oliver, did you want to come in?
Yeah, no, it was really just to go back to the point around the statement. Are you not concerned, you know, that if whether it's the Scottish Parliament, Scottish Government, you know, if politicians are seen to be making statements, particularly, you know, when it comes into some of these pilot areas and other bits and pieces, it starts to kind of call into question the kind of democratic legitimacy of the, you know, of the board or things they're planning. I just worry, you know, is that kind of stolen election type stuff. We've had colleagues come here, you know, and talk about randomised ballot papers, about other, you know, quite novel electoral provisions, you know, that you'll have candidates or, you know, potentially political parties saying they've been disadvantaged or cheated, and that, you know, do you think we get into that kind of space? Is it not better to keep it completely separate from politicians?
And I think a balance has to be struck. By and large, yes, of course, on an operational basis, the Electoral Management Board must be able to operate independently of political direction, political interference. I think that's a given. I think we would all agree with that. I suppose, insofar as, and I've made the point around activity the Electoral Commission might undertake, funded by the Scottish Government, you know, we can't compel the Electoral Commission to undertake work. So it would be through the process of dialogue and agreement. And of course, Parliament is a pluralistic entity, and if any individual members of Scottish Parliament have concerns, then of course they will raise that. If organisations out there have concerns, I'm sure they'll raise that voice. I think by and large we have a transparent, open, democratic system that enables people to raise their concerns and for us to deliberate upon them. But yeah,
there's a difference between raising those concerns in the way you're describing, you know, and having kind of formal statements, you know, that set out either a definitive position or collate views in a kind of definitive way. I think that kind of ups, you know, that kind of ups the, you know, how seriously, you know, an independent body would be expected to take those things into account.
Yeah, I think this is where we've got to be careful, and that's why I would suggest it's something they have to have regard to rather than they must undertake specific actions. So
it's different to being consulted, isn't it? You know, I would expect politicians and government, you know, elected representatives, you know, a wide range of stakeholders to be consulted, you know, on changes, plans and ideas. But it's something different, you know, when you know, some of those stakeholders you know, are given the chance to make a formal statement, you know, that's to be given due regard. That's something a bit different.
Well, it is different. I suppose I think we still need to reflect on the fact that Parliament has been democratically elected. The people have determined that that we are the 129 individual that should represent them, who we are accountable to them at the ballot box. And I don't think it's unreasonable that we might have a point of view that we may want to express as something that the board should have regard to. I certainly think if that crossed the line into the board had to do certain things, that's where I would start to get concerned. But you're right to raise these things, Mr. Mundell, because this is the area that we just need to get the balance right. So my perspective is I think it's sensible for, and I'm still open to whether it should be government and or Parliament to be able to make such a statement, doing it in a manner that's appropriate, proportionate, and does not compromise the independence of the board. That's the bottom line.
Okay. Leave it there for now.
Thank you. Anyone else have any comments before I pass you over to Ruth, if I may, to look at another element of this?
You know, good morning, Minister. I'd like to ask about secondary legislation and then have a question about electoral pilots. I wonder what update the government can provide committee on the further consultation with key stakeholders in the new areas that were being considered for amendment.
In terms of secondary legislation as proposed in the bill, or secondary legislation?
There is clearly primary legislation that has created secondary legislation already,
yes,
which will continue. There is also some secondary legislation being hinted at in this bill, and it's really just, I think, to find out where the government are on this, because there seems to be a huge amount of secondary legislation where initial discussions were had when this bill was very broad that has now been narrowed. And I think it's really just to try and establish where the government are on it.
We continue to engage with those who have an interest in these areas. I mean, I would reflect that I think I'm right in saying DPLRC have obviously looked at the powers that we would propose could be made through secondary legislation. Of course, it's not unusual for a bill to lay out that provisions can be taken forward by secondary legislation. I don't think they've expressed any particular concerns about the provisions that we've laid out. We will, of course, continue to engage in dialogue with those who have an interest in either the appropriateness of including things as secondary regulation making powers on the face of the bill, or indeed how we might utilise them going forward.
I wonder, can you speak a bit to how the Scottish Government makes that decision about what to take forward in primary and what to take forward in secondary?
Well, I could speak to that in general terms rather than just in relation to this bill. I think by and large the judgment is that where we think things are of a nature that circumstances could change quite quickly, and we need to make a fairly quick change, and it's appropriate to put that in secondary legislation. It would be one element where matters evolve and circumstances change, then it might be more appropriate to do that via secondary legislation rather than the face of primary legislation, because, stating the obvious, you know, trying to do something by primary legislation takes longer than it does by secondary legislation. At the end of the day, all secondary legislation is still has to be placed before Parliament and agreed by Parliament. So okay. There still is that process for deliberation and accountability.
And with that in mind, are there likely additional areas of electoral law which the Scottish Government will seek to change by secondary legislation prior to the next Scottish Parliament election?
Yeah, so there is. Some of this doesn't relate to this bill because obviously there's secondary legislation making powers just now. So you know, what we've laid out thus far are areas including amending the dissolution period before Scottish Parliament elections, looking at the definition of notional expenditure for candidate spending. I've already talked about some of the areas in relation to intimidation. There's also, I think, associated with that concerns around undue influence, so looking at the definition there. This is an issue that I actually have reflected on before and I think is important. Clearly, as it goes back to the convener's point about equivalence in terms of treatment of councillors and parliamentarians, we as candidates for Parliament are able to put their residence as the constituency in which we reside. We think it should be possible for those standing for councils to say the ward in which they reside, so that's something they're looking to take forward, giving election agents the option of providing a correspondence address. One that I think probably will create some conversation, I've already spoken to Jeremy Balfour about it, is replacing the requirement for a tactile voting device with a wider responsibility for returning officers to provide appropriate support. Happy to discuss that one further. Allowing Boundary Scotland to access limited electoral register retainer data when conducting reviews, so they can also look at those who are going to come onto the register when they come of age. Allowing emergency proxy votes for those accompanying people to medical appointments. So these are things we have said that we will do. There are a range of other areas where we're considering what the position might be, you know, areas around candidate mailings, for example, what might be on polling cards, could you put on additional information to help with accessibility, for example. So there are areas that we've said what we will do, and there are other areas that we're considering. Some of that, you know, is obviously interlinks with this legislation, but isn't necessarily, doesn't require this legislation, because we have that ability to do these things with secondary legislation just now.
Okay, are you okay? Okay, thank you. That's helpful. In terms of potential electoral pilots, I think one of the things that we'd all in this room be very concerned about is participation and ensuring that as many people take part in elections as possible. Is there scope within the electoral pilots for automatic voter registration, for example? Does the government have a position on
that? So one of the things we were asked to do and we will be doing is bring forward an amendment to make clear that pilots can focus on areas around registration as well. I know there is interest in this area. I've spoken with the Electoral Reform Society around this. They're very keen on us taking, or there being a pilot, not necessarily the government takes forward a pilot. I'm wide open to considering that. I know that, I think, I don't know if the evidence has been given directly to the committee, but some electoral registration officers have expressed some concerns around that in terms of the quality of the data, depending on the source you draw it down from. Is it still current? Is it still up to date, for example? So there are issues involved, which might lend itself to saying that that's why there should be a pilot. So we haven't, as a government, said that there definitely should be one in terms of automatic registration, but what we want to do is make clear that that is something that could be piloted.
Okay, thank you. Thanks,
Can I, are you talking about automatic registration or are you talking about assisted registration? Because I think there is a very subtle difference between the two, in the sense that an automatic registration as a pilot, you either do it or you don't. But the assisted registration, I think, speaks to the data challenge that exists because of various other reasons and quality of data held. So is it automatic registration, i.e. people will be automatically registered when it becomes apparent they should be on the register? Or is it assisted registration where there's a positive outreach to people to say, you can now be registered, you know, this is all you need to do?
Well, I was speaking about automatic registration, but equally there has been a suggestion that there could be pilots to assist the registration process through utilising other data sources or points at which people register their information with, for example, let's just say the National Health Service or other council services. Could there be a means by which they can also simultaneously register to vote? So that again would be something I think could be piloted. And of course, the purpose of pilots, the convener, are to learn from them, and if they work, then we can consider making an actual feature of our system. Wales are, of course, looking at this issue just now, so we will be able to look and see how their experience has been.
I mean, there is an element with the automatic registration as a pilot, then it becomes almost slightly, I use this ever so slightly flippantly, a postcode lottery if you happen to be in that pilot. Because actually, when you look at some of the figures that are put out about the number of people who are not on the electoral register, it would make it could potentially make a very significant difference to the electoral pool in relation to an election in one area, be it a council election or indeed be it the Scottish election, and whether or not there is something, if we agree that automatic registration should take place in principle, it's something that should happen universally across, so that no individual voter is excluded, but the flip side of it is actually it gives a playing ground across the whole of Scotland.
No, I mean, that's a reasonable point, and I suppose there's a certain tension there between, well, you know, we want to see if this works, so we have to pilot in a certain area. That is then balanced against, well, you're adding a feature or a facet to electoral registration in only one or more, but not the entirety of the country. So, you know, that would be something that would have to, I think, be considered as part of any pilot.
Excellent, thank you. Sorry, Joe, did you want to come in? Or was that the fact? There's just a couple of the other secondary bits of legislation, which I hope, if you don't mind, Minister, it might be actually easier for the committee to write to you, basically for an update on each of the areas you've highlighted, plus the others, and in particular for the benefit of other members who aren't on this committee, with regard to tactile devices. I think that's one that a number of members are rightly concerned about for reassurance.
Yeah, I'm happy to speak to that a little.
I was going to say, if you wanted to express more of where the government is with that, I think it might be beneficial.
Convener, so I can understand that on the face of it, it might seem a concern that we are no longer prescribing that there should be the tactile device that's been deployed. And I say it in that sense because what's prescribed is the utilisation of one type of device, which, frankly, is probably being overtaken by new developments that might be a little better. So whilst it might, on face value, say, well, why are you removing what's prescribed because that's there to assist people? Well, actually, what we want to do is make sure that there's a wide range of more appropriate support. And I'm happy to talk through been done just now. There's a subgroup of the Electoral Management Board on accessibility, which includes representatives from
councils, from the Electoral Commission, from the Scottish Government, looking at a range of issues. So one area is looking at enhancing the existing polling place finder app. That's an app that's provided by a charity called Democracy Club, which is available for anyone to use to find where the polling place might be, but is, we think, particularly helpful for those with sight loss to find their polling place. We're looking to see if we can enhance that. Trials of that are expected to start shortly. There's also a tactile ballot paper overlay which is being developed, which is probably the most relevant one in relation to the existing tactile voting device. In a nutshell, the difference here is that the overlay that's been designed works with specific ballot papers. It's designed around the size of the actual ballot papers people will be using, whereas the tactile voting device that exists just now isn't quite the same. It has to be affixed by a person in the polling station. Doesn't necessarily match the exact size of each ballot paper, so you can see why the change might lend itself to being an improvement. Other areas also looking at greater audio support with automated telephone lines. These were actually piloted at the Assembly elections in Northern Ireland in 2022 and were successfully piloted. They've been rolled out for local elections in Northern Ireland last year, where a voter can phone a helpline for information on how to cast a vote with details around who's standing. The anecdotal evidence shows that it wasn't taken up in huge numbers, but those who used it, found it very helpful, and it was not an expensive innovation. The costs of setting it up were around £10,000, so the Electoral Management Board subgroup is in the process of setting up a similar trial here in Scotland. And the other that's been looked at are digital poll cards, which we think could be helpful as well in terms of benefiting certain groups of people in terms of being able to get their polling card in a digital format. So hopefully that gives some sense of reassurance that what we're seeking to do here isn't to actually reduce the quality of support available to people. Actually, what we're looking to do is enhance it.
Joe, do you want to just come in on that?
Just on that last point, we know that in the election just passed for Westminster, a number of people didn't manage to cast their vote because they didn't have proof of ID. And I just wonder whether there's an opportunity to look at whether the UK government might work with you on that digital poll card, which actually might help a number of folk who don't have a passport or a driving licence. And we're too late to go and apply for something else, but if there was something coming out.
Well, we'd be very happy to do that, Mr Fitzpatrick. I actually had a conversation with my counterpart in the UK, Government Alex Norris, just earlier this week. It was a very useful, fruitful discussion. I think actually there's a lot that we agree on. I would take this opportunity, of course, to make clear that we still have no intention of creating any requirement for people to take ID to cast their vote. I pressed at that point with Mr Norris as well. I don't think it should be a requirement at UK elections as well. We don't have responsibility for legislating for such, but did make very clear that I still see there being, in its government's perspective, that there's no necessity for that as a requirement, and hopefully they will act accordingly. But where we can work together on these things, then I'm absolutely committed to doing so.
Thanks, Joe. Annie, do you want to have
no,
a look?
No,
are you sure?
Yeah.
Right, oh, Oliver. Yeah.
It was just to ask on the current tactile device, do you not think it would offer reassurance to some people to say that would continue to be available, you know, until these other options are developed? I don't understand why that's a difficult thing. You know, we're all accepting there are better things out there, you know, but people are legitimately concerned that something they're used to using is going to be taken away. Is it not quite easy to?
No, it could be, and I've not closed down that option, I should say, Mr. Mundell. It may be that there's for a transition period that we can make clear that that will still be available. I would say, you know, this is a change that's been made south of the border.
Yeah.
These were concerns raised at the time, but actually I think the practical experience has been such that the concerns no longer remain because the other devices and the other approaches have been successful. But I'm open to considering that matter if it's felt to be some form of reassurance.
Is there an existence? Your electoral staff are used to using them. I just think it wouldn't do any harm, and it might give people confidence. What you're saying, but as in it would give them confidence that they're not going to be disenfranchised in the short term.
Yeah, no, I mean it's something I'm open to persuasion on. It would be again, it's for the committee to consider who it wants to take evidence from. Maybe useful hearing the perspective of returning officers in terms of this matter as well, because I think they've got a perspective on it. I think you've accepted this point. The bottom line that we must press, though, is that there is no desire to reduce the quality of support that's available. On the contrary, what we want to do is enhance it and actually improve it. But if, you know, in the process of conversation with all stakeholders, it's felt that this could offer a degree of reassurance, then I'm open to hearing that.
So there's a couple, as I say, if you're happy, Minister, for the committee to write to you about generically on some of the secondary legislation. But I was going to ask you about the anonymous registration and the extension in relation to domestic abuse protection orders, and where are the government in relation to that, given proposed changes in other parts of the country that may affect people there, and if they move to Scotland, whether they're able to apply for an anonymous registration because of the risk, the psychological harm, the physical and or psychological harm that they're put at risk of. So I understand we still need to make the changes.
Yeah,
here.
So we're looking at, I think, on, well, I would hope that most people would recognise that it's a sensible to do. So we're still going through the process of looking at how we put that into.
So we don't have a time scale for that moment.
No,
that's fine.
But I'll be happy to write to the committee.
Yeah, as I said, I'll probably encompass it in correspondence. And the other one is in relation, ironically, to the next day counts. So do you count overnight, or do you give the staff a break and come back the following morning slightly more refreshed? One of the things that in your letter you talked about was reaching out for the views of the Scottish Parliament. Mm-hmm. And again, to go back to where we started, today, is that the Scottish Parliament is a corporate body, or is that the Scottish Parliament is made up by the members, and if so, where are you with that consultation?
Well, I think it's largely with members. I suppose, you know, that kind of starts today. I'm happy to hear what people think. I mean, I'm kind of torn between. Well, actually, I'm not torn between two issues. Instinctively, I quite like the overnight count. I don't know what others around this table think, but I'm willing to bet they also like the overnight count. However, we've obviously heard there might be some practical considerations. We have to take that seriously. We have to consider that. You know, it's also got to be balanced against the practical experience that, as far as I can see, there haven't been significant major difficulties with overnight counts thus far. But if there's a perspective being articulated that it might be more appropriate to do it the next day, then, of course, we've got to look at that and consider it. But I need to be persuaded on its merits, but I'm keen to hear what other members think as well.
So I've no intention of polling the members of the committee now on their individual decisions, and as a committee view, we too would need to take evidence on that. I'm just wondering about, in practical terms, how you intend to do that with the members of the Scottish Parliament, because we have spoken. I very much echo the attitude of the Scottish Government that this bill and election bills is something that, in essence, belongs to Parliament,
yep,
facilitated rightly by the Scottish Government. And I think these are the sort of issues where to actually see how that consultation is intending to be conducted would be useful.
Well, I mean, being perfectly candid with you, Convener, I suppose I've just thought I'm operating on an open door basis, and you know, let me place that on the record now. If any member of the Scottish Parliament wants to speak to me about any element of this bill, I'm happy to do so. If it's felt that it might be useful to have some other form of consultation, then I'm happy to give that some consideration, although it wouldn't be our usual approach. But you know, as you rightly make the point, and I share the perspective, this is Parliament's bill, so
yes. And in relation to the overnight counts, I specifically chose that because that's the one area where, interestingly, in your correspondence, you've pointed out an intention to consult with the Scottish Parliament. And I think there's a difference between an open door policy, which I absolutely endorse and understand that you have and I have used on occasions, to actually a consultation where members are actively, or indeed anyone who's consulted, is actively approached with a proposal to seek their views. I think there's a different emphasis on that. And if you are then going to draw from that consultation a conclusion, yeah, it's helpful to know how it happened.
I'm being reminded with a well, it's not that discreet because I'm about to say discreet note from Ian that the Scottish Parliament political parties panel has also been contacted. So that is another means by which we've engaged for views.
As always, Ian anticipates my very final question. Do you yet have a meeting date for that political party panel to discuss?
I await a reply.
You await a reply. Excellent. Do any members of the committee want to cover anything before? Is there anything that you would like to add, Minister, before?
At this stage, no, Convener, but I'm very grateful for the opportunity to speak with you about the matter. You know, as much as I'm giving my perspective, I'm genuinely interested in other people's perspective as well. So
absolutely, and I welcome the comments in a number of different formats about seeking the views of this committee. I find that both reassuring and helpful. But of course, the committee's views in some way have to be based on evidence that we hear, and it's an opportunity for those outside of this place at various levels to participate in that. But can I thank you for you and your officials attending today? Always illuminating. And we will be in touch in correspondence. So can I thank you. I will now move this meeting into private.